Dean, I thank you for your very kind words. Appreciate that very much. I'm sorry that you've taken most of my time now, however. What a great joy to be with you today and to be a part of the conference and the gathering. I'm really honored to be with you and looking forward to this time sharing with you. And I'll tell you right from the beginning, my main objective is just to thank you and to encourage you for all that you do. But I do bring you greetings today from Concordia University, Wisconsin, where I have been privileged to serve now for, this is my 24th year at Concordia, including my 18th year as president. And the time has gone by fast, to be sure. Concordia has been in Mequa now for 32 years. And this is a drone backyard view of our campus. When we moved there, I would suggest that we had a vision for the future, but it wasn't an immeasurable one. It was a measurable one. But what has happened has really certainly exceeded our imagination. We've grown from a student population of about 500 students when we arrived on campus to a student enrollment this year of over 8,100. We've experienced considerable growth of the campus facility. The bluff has been restored. Just a little interesting story to kind of give you a sense of how things went beyond what we expected. In this picture, you can kind of see, well, you see the lake there along the side, and to the top end of the picture, you see a property across the street. This was a parcel of about 40 acres that would have been a part of the original deal for the campus. We acquired the campus from the School Sisters of Notre Dame, so Concordia was once upon a time a Roman Catholic convent. Their original asking price for the property was $27 million, but they came all the way down to $8 million in order to sell it to a place that would provide Christian education. But along the way, they also offered us the 40 acres that were across the street for an additional $200,000. And we passed. We'd already sort of extended ourselves, right? $8 million was a lot of money, and I'm not being hypercritical here. It was a big leap of faith to move out there in the first place. But when Concordia began gradually to erode into Lake Michigan and we had to remove 400,000 cubic yards of soil somewhere, we went back to the school sisters who still owned this property, and we bought it from them a quarter century later for $3.2 million. The nuns had improved in their negotiating skills. But as I laid the check before Sister Marilyn Kessler, I asked her, whatever happened to that vow of poverty thing that you guys used to... I also bring you greetings from Concordia University, Ann Arbor. And as of July 1st, 2013, a new day when these two Concordia's became one university, and we are today one university with two campuses, two residential campuses. We're maintaining two distinct brands, CUW, CUAA, the blue and white, and the red and black, the Falcons and the Cardinals, and we do not point out that in nature Falcons often eat Cardinals. We don't mention that. That's not the spirit of what we're after. We are one university with two residential campuses, and we are blessed. Concordia Ann Arbor's been around now. This is our 51st year. And when we got started with the conversation, there were about 500 or 600 students, and this year our census is up over 800 and growing. But we're just beginning to imagine. We're seeing all kinds of improvements on campus. The science building has been renovated. There's been lots of other curb appeal projects that have enhanced the beauty of an already beautiful campus. We're looking forward to a year from now when we expect that the Kreft Center, on the 25th anniversary of that building being dedicated, will be completely remodeled. We're going to see the completion of the football stadium with the stadium seating and the locker rooms as a part of that, all of that on tap for next summer. And we rejoice at the ways in which this new relationship is blossoming and beginning to flourish. But I'm here today also to tell you that we certainly need you in this. And your partnership in this with us has been so critical already, and it will be every step along the way. We need you to send your kids to Concordia. We need you to pray for us, and we need to be able to help you too. And again, that's partly what I'm eager to do today. We are beyond seeking what's beyond what we could ask for or imagine, your theme for this gathering. That's true, of course, for all generations, whether it's the founding of Concordia in 1881 or Concordia Ann Arbor in 1963, certainly well before that. And the promise here in this epistle is that God will do always immeasurably more. But what God accomplishes is not always measured by success. It's not always measured by success that we can see, that we can access. We don't always see the results. And what is beyond our imagination may also be beyond our understanding or even beyond our appreciation. We're talking about Concordia Ann Arbor and the business decision to take over responsibility for this campus. It was the right decision for Concordia University, Wisconsin, even if it didn't work out as we planned. If a single life is touched, if a single soul is reached for the gospel, the angels in heaven will rejoice. And it was worth our time, our energy, our money. No, not every story is going to be a success story, at least not the way that we define success in the world. One such story is one that I've told before, and apologies to those of you who have heard parts of this at one time or another. At least this time I have a few pictures. So this is Baden Hall. It's on the campus of what was once known as St. John's College, Winfield, Kansas. Any Johnnies in the crowd? Yeah. We really are a dying breed. So this is the original building. It was founded in 1883, just 2 years after Concordia, Milwaukee. Hail St. John's College, hail, champion of truth in all the West, the best, the home of youth. My alma mater, which ends in the last stanza, ne'er will thy spirit die. The Johnny spirit's all that we have left. Because in 1986, lacking imagination and without option, St. John's College closed its doors. Now, all that happened, though, 9 years after I enrolled as a freshman. The Winfield Daily Courier announced that I was coming to St. John's College. I was a basketball, I'm the one on the left. Although the hair is different. Anyway, I was a basketball player in high school, and it really was the only reason that I decided to go to St. John's. And that's because it was the only school in all of North America that recognized my athletic prowess and was going to allow me to be on their team. Yes, that's me on the left. I had a little bit more hair then. And I'm glad the picture's in black and white because you can't tell that that's a yellow polyester leisure suit that I'm wearing. And I'm just glad I wasn't wearing the puka shells at the time as I did sometimes. Anyway, if you read in that article there, though, it's interesting. I looked at it yesterday. They not only published my statistics, they also published my grade point average. Now, just try to get away with that today with FERPA regulations. The other guy, by the way, in the picture is a fellow by the name of Greg Levine. And according to the Winfield Daily Courier article, he was from Lutheran High School in Detroit, Michigan. Does anybody know Greg Levine? Anybody know him? Really? I do not know Greg Levine personally because I never met him. He never came. Maybe he knew something I didn't know. But in the intervening time between when this article was published and Greg decided not to come to St. John's, I was also having some very, very serious second thoughts. This is a photograph of my mother. She's standing in the driveway of the home that my father still owns in Denver, Colorado, the home where I was raised. And it was taken, I think, about the time that I was going to go to college. I know for sure that that's the Ford Granada that we packed up with all of my important worldly belongings to take along with me to college. Several pair of Chuck Taylor Converse high-top all-star basketball shoes. A stereo that I'd inherited from my older brother that shorted out and made this terrible buzzing sound in all my record albums. My Raleigh racer bicycle that I spent a lot of money that I'd earned working that summer to own. And we put it all in the car, and then we began one early morning to make the 500-mile trek from our home in Denver to Winfield, Kansas. Now, there were no Johnnies, or at least no one who admitted to being a Johnny earlier. But have any of you, oh good, there are a few. I can't see that well from here at the lights in my eyes. But, have any of the rest of you ever been to Winfield? Anybody else been to Winfield, Kansas? You know, there are a couple. It's not in the middle of nowhere. I like to say you can see it from there, but it's not in the middle of nowhere. And so we're making this trip from my wonderful hometown, Denver, Colorado, beautiful place, and we're traveling across Interstate 70, and it's hot, and the car doesn't have any air conditioning, so the windows are down, the air is blowing in, and we're going now through fields of wheat and leaving behind us the purple mountain majesty. But the worst thing is that every mile we traveled took me one more mile away from home. And I can tell you now that I was homesick before I ever reached Winfield, before I ever reached campus. In fact, when we got to St. John's College, we unpacked our belongings, and I went and I rode my bicycle, the one that I'd paid my hard-earned money for. I rode it over to my parents' hotel, the Camelot Inn, right on Main Street, and I was ready to walk up to knock on their door and just ask them, to plead with them, can I get back in the Granada tomorrow and ride back home with you? But I didn't, because I'd come to play basketball, and I was determined to try and do just that. Now, this was August or September, so I had a little while before the season started. And one way to allay homesickness, obviously, was to try and stay in communication with my family. And the way that I did that, really, was mostly by writing and receiving letters. This particular picture is of me standing before the mailbox on a rare day when I had no mail that came to me, because that just didn't happen very often my freshman year. And I made sure that didn't happen because I wrote letters so that I could get some in return. I would write letters during class. I would write letters instead of class. I would write letters late into the night so that when I came down in the morning, there might be something in my box from someone back home. Kids have it so easy today, don't they? I mean, even as I've been standing here myself, my phone keeps buzzing in my pants pocket, alerting me that I have emails or Facebook or tweets or something of some sort. They have it a lot easier. We didn't have that luxury. I mean, we had telephones. We had the payphone. And my parents and I had this system worked out that if I wanted to talk to them, I didn't want to call collect because that was expensive. So I would go up to the payphone and I would dial person to person and ask for Pat, for myself. And they could honestly then answer, well, no, he's not here. And then they would call back and I'd answer the phone because a direct call was the cheapest way to do it. Generally speaking, though, if the phone rang, you didn't answer it because it wasn't for you, and so you'd let it ring on and on interminably, and letters were a much better way to go. I was perhaps already a budding historian at that time because I kept all of the letters that my family and friends wrote to me, and I had a chance to go back through those a few years ago. And incidentally, my mother also kept all of the letters that I wrote to her that freshman year, so I was able to kind of reconstruct a conversation that occurred between us. And I have to tell you, it was a pathetic one. It was a lamentable, an embarrassing one, really. A sad story of loneliness, of homesickness, and it's a story that I had a hard time with at that time. But eventually, October came, and basketball season started. This is my team, my freshman year. There's no Greg Levine from Detroit in that picture, because maybe he knew something I didn't. Maybe he knew that this was going to become the worst team in the history of college basketball. Immeasurably worse. These guys and I, we before Christmas, jumped out to an 0-11 start. And that took us home for the holiday, and I was an inch away from not going back. But someone in that group persuaded me that I should come back at least for January, because in January we had this tournament that we were going to host, kind of a version of the CIT basketball tournament, but it included St. John's College, Concordia, Austin, Texas, Concordia, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and St. Paul's College, Concordia, Missouri. So we play Concordia, Texas, the first round. That's where my daughter Rachel eventually would go to school. They beat us, too. And then we play Concordia, Milwaukee. They had a really good team back then. They still do today. But they trounced us. And yet there was just this element of hope, because we had seen St. Paul's College also play two games, and they looked every bit as woeful as we were. And the game sort of played out that way. We actually led at halftime. It was the first time all season that we led at halftime. And as we came into the locker room, we really weren't sure how we should behave. We were sort of giggling. And then we went back out for the second half, and things quickly returned to normal. But then there was a surge. There was a surge. And then it was back and forth, until finally on a last-second shot, by a freshman guard from Denver, Colorado, who will otherwise remain anonymous, we won by 1 point. And so you might say, well, then obviously Greg Levine had it wrong. You weren't the worst team in the history of college basketball, because you beat St. Paul's College from Concordia, Missouri. Just a little more to this part of the story. This was January. The Monday following that little tournament, we received the very bad news that four of the five other starters on our team were academically ineligible for the second semester. So not only were we not very athletic, we weren't particularly bright either. And a few of the other fellas decided to hang it up, a couple injuries. We show up at our next game with only four guys. And five are required for a basketball team, right? So we literally had to grab a few guys from the bleachers. I don't know why anybody would have been in the bleachers, but there were a few guys. One guy said he was in the concession stand. We placed a phone call to the dorm. Fortunately, someone answered, and all of those guys then were our team for the rest of the season. There they are. I don't know why you're laughing. Truly, this was the worst team ever. Beyond imagination. We had players on our team who did not play in high school, who were not planning to play intramurals, but they were the St. John's Eagles the rest of the season. A season that ended with one win and 25 losses. But some of those losses in the second half of the season were truly of epic proportion. Just one example. We lost to Barton County Community College, 148-50. It's not like we gave up 98 points. We lost by 98 points. And it was the only game all season where at the very end we were stalling to try and avert a triple-digit defeat. And we were successful. You laughed at the guys here, but, you know, our coach, you can't make this out in the picture, but He's also wearing a leisure suit. It's black. Our school colors were black and orange, and often for games, he would wear orange socks and an orange shirt with white buck shoes. Before one game, unfortunately, he wore glasses, and he was hit by a basketball thrown by a band member, and his glasses broke, and we don't have an assistant coach, so he came out of the locker room a few minutes late for the start of the game with his black horn-rimmed glasses with white tape holding it together. And if dressing for success were our objective, we got exactly what we deserved. But our basketball team learned what St. Paul meant when he said, let me tell you what he said before he said what he said. Okay, first of all, he quotes the psalmist and he says, all we like sheep face the slaughter. If ever there was a passage that we could relate to, it was that one, right? We knew every time we set foot on the court, home or away, that we were going to be slaughtered, right? We knew every time. It wasn't as if he could stand up in front of the chalkboard, you know, put X's and O's up there, and if we just do that this time, if only we do that this time, maybe this time it will be different. No, it didn't matter. All we like sheep face the slaughter, St. Paul says, talking about our Christian experience. We face famine, we face peril, we face nakedness, we face sword. But here is the key point. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through Jesus who loved us. We weren't losers. In Christ, we were more than champions. And what was so significant about that to me was that it was news to me. Some of you know that already. This was news to me because I didn't go to St. John's College planning to become the president of the largest Lutheran university in North America, or now one with two residential campuses. I wasn't planning to be a Lutheran pastor or a Lutheran college professor or a Lutheran for that matter. I just went because they said I could. But my life was transformed in the context of that freshman year experience. And what was news for me also was news for my roommate, my friend, Reed Lessing, who's going to be your essayist next summer for your convention. He came with me from Denver, went through a very similar sort of experience. And what was news for us was also news for my family, my younger sister who followed me to St. John's and who later was baptized and confirmed, my mother, so that she wouldn't have to go to confirmation class on her own. Went along with her once just to join her as company, and then she went herself to be confirmed into the church. And then an older brother, and then his wife, and then my other older brother, and my father. You know, I went back to Colorado for graduate school. I had my father in my confirmation class. You know, you talk about preacher's kids in confirmation. Try having your own dad as one of your confirmants. Stubborn guy. And so then all my family became members of the church, and now my mom, the one who stood there by the Granada in the driveway, she stands beside Jesus in the nearer presence of Jesus in heaven. And who do I thank for that? I thank you for that. I thank Bethlehem Lutheran Church and School in Lakewood, Colorado. I didn't go there. But my next door neighbors went there. Every one of those kids went through that school. And it was only because of them that I ended up at St. John's College. And the point to be made is this. You folks don't even know. You can't even begin to know the impact that you're having. And you may never know. Unless someone tells you. And that's why I'm here today, to tell you that you are having an impact beyond all imagination. Just a little postscript before I take us in another direction. I got to the hotel yesterday and my phone rang, and on the other end was a fellow who said, this is a voice from your past, a friend from your past. It wasn't Greg Levine. It was another guy, though, from Detroit, Michigan, who came to St. John's College the next year, a fellow by the name of John Allison Westbrook, Jay Westbrook. Does anybody know Jay? Well, he somehow knew I was coming here. He called me up. We're going to get together tonight a little later on. I haven't seen him in 37 years. He was a freshman on the St. John's team the second year that we played, and that second year we won 4 games, including a victory over Barton County Community College. And Jay Westbrook, he was the man. Isn't that cool? I'll get to see him tonight. Athletics is a means for ministry. That's true on our Concordia campuses, certainly. But it's also a metaphor. Athletics is also a metaphor for our Christian life and experience. And I want to use a metaphor of a different athletic activity to tell a story. Basketball was the sport of my youth. Well, running has become the acquired taste and preference for my adult life. This passage, did we already go through that one from Hebrews there? Let's go. This passage from Hebrews, since we're surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. The joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And this passage, of course, follows that great Hebrews Hall of Fame, chapter 11, all of those heroes of faith who've run before us, who inspire us now as we continue our own arduous race. Now this picture. This is the person who introduced me to running. That's my lovely wife, Tammy. And I got involved in running because I had to chase her in order to court her. That's not an easy thing to do because she's fast. She's always running races and she's always winning medals. My philosophy is much different from hers. Some of you know it. I like to start out slow and then back off. But I am serious about my running. Martin Luther was once asked, What if somebody told you that the world would end tomorrow? What would you do? Do you remember what he said? He said he'd plant a tree. You might recall that some were saying that on December 20th, 2012, that was the day before the world was supposed to end, according to the Mayan calendar, right? So I thought about planting a tree, but December 20th in Milwaukee, it didn't work. So instead of that, I began a running streak. And so today, presuming that I get out before dinner and before I see Jay Westbrook afterward, today will be the 664th straight day of running for me, of at least a mile a day, and averaging about 4.5 miles. So I'm a little bit obsessive about it. This picture is of my wife Tammy and I after last year's Lakefront Marathon in Wisconsin. Tammy is beautiful, isn't she? Even after 26.2 miles of running, it was a beautiful day. It was a good race. There are those times in the race when everything seems to go just right. This is our running family. 3 of our kids here, our son-in-law, my son's girlfriend, 2 of our sons are missing. They still play basketball. Their athletic preferences have yet to fully mature. Nevertheless, we all support each other and we encourage one another. My daughter Hannah is the one second to the right. She took it a step further this summer. Can we get that next one? This is the Coeur d'Alene Ironman in Idaho this past summer. Here you'll see Hannah. She's right there in her pink cap. and she's ready to take a plunge into the choppy waters on a windy, cool morning with a few thousand of her best friends for the 2-mile open swim. This is Team Hannah, about half of us here in the picture. We came all the way to Idaho to support her, however we could do that, mainly through cheering and yelling and screaming mostly. Her sister Rachel is right there in the middle giving the thumbs up, easy for Rachel to say. Hannah emerges from the water. She's running in the transition area toward the next leg. She hops onto her bike for a 112-mile ride. Some portion of that up a 6% grade of mountain. There's not much during this period of time for Team Hannah to do but wait. and to go to town and eat lunch. Rachel is now double thumbs up as she downs her cheeseburger while her sister pedals away on for 6 or 7 hours. The bike ride ended. Hannah is nearly finished. Only 26.2 miles of running marathon remains. And we post ourselves along the course at various points along the way. And whenever I saw her, I tried to embarrass her by blowing my vuvuzela as loud as I could, like there was no tomorrow. Along the course, she finds pace partners, including this guy with whom she ran for many miles as they helped each other along the way. And finally, 13 hours, 20 minutes after she began, she finishes to a cheering crowd, a crowd that cheered her and others all day long. She shows off her finisher medal, and she thanks her well-fed support team for being a part of the experience. And I have to tell you, it really was a very moving experience. Well, I mean, it was a wonderful experience, an incredible experience. It was an exhausting experience for me, and probably for her too. It was inspirational to me, and it was something that psyched me up to get ready for this year's Lakefront Marathon. Fast forward from last June, the Ironman, to 9 days ago. No, this is not the reunion picture of my St. John's basketball team. This is the Concordia faculty, staff, and student marathon team that ran this year's Lakefront Marathon, just a year after my great race on that wonderful day on that same course. And I was ready to roll. Now, just for the record, I think this team of runners would have given that St. John's basketball team a run for the money and on the court too as well anyway. So, okay, this year, I have to tell you, the race didn't go as well for me. And you can probably make some of that out just by looking at this picture. This is actually on the campus of Concordia University, Wisconsin. We've just passed the 7 mile mark. And what do you notice that's different about me from everybody else that's running that you can see there? You notice? Yeah. It was 30-something degrees at the start, and I dressed up like it was Antarctica, right? I've got on running tights, I've got on Under Armour, and by the time I'm up 2 miles into the race, I'm already overheating. And I'm kicking myself, thinking that what a stupid thing that was. And by the time I get here to Concordia, we have a cheering crowd, the band's out, the cheerleaders are out there, so I can make it through that. I'm still doing all right, but I'm feeling kind of nervous. And then by the time I reach the 10th mile, my mind is working hard on me, and my body is not cooperating very well either, and I'm beginning to wonder, am I going to reach my goals? By mile 13, I was still on goal pace, but I knew there was no way I was going to reach him. I was cooked, literally and pretty much figuratively too. And so when I reached mile 16, I made a very difficult decision. I made up my mind that when I reached the 18th mile, where my wife Tammy I knew was going to be to kind of cheer me on, I made up my mind that I was going to pull out of the race at that point. Tammy was not the only one at mile 18. Hannah was also there. And they saw me coming a little slower than we'd anticipated. And at mile 18, Hannah jumped in. And I told her I couldn't do it anymore. I was going to quit. Well, maybe just a little more, but I was going to quit by 20 for sure, and told Tammy to be there to pick us up. But Hannah, she coached, she coaxed, she cajoled, she ran with me the last 8 miles to the finish line. And at mile 16, I could not have imagined finishing that day. There was no way. She stepped in to help me. To help me finish the race. It wasn't my best day. Well, maybe the more I think about it, the more I consider it, maybe it was the best day after all. The great cloud of witnesses who have run the race before us, this great cloud surrounds us, Hebrews says. Runners love clouds to kind of block the sun, to keep us cool. But we love this cloud of witnesses. We love their example. Their example cheers us. These are ones who have run the difficult course. They've run the course. They've won the prize. They cheer us. And behind us, you know this better than any, behind us come still others. And we spend nearly every day of our lives, every day of our careers, helping to set the pace, encouraging them, the next generation. That's what teachers do. That's what youth workers do. That's what pastors do with their confirmands. They're coming behind us. We want to help them along the way. Those before us, those who come after us. But right here, right now, we run alongside each other. We are part of this generation of church workers called to serve here and now for such a time as this. We are in it together. And I know there's some days that go pretty well. Everything, everybody, bright, beautiful, all just clicks, all smiles. You've heard of days like that? More often, we need help and we need support. And some of that comes from the sidelines, from people like me today, standing up here, tooting your horn, encouraging you, asking you to believe in yourselves. You are making a difference, even if it's not apparent. You and people like you have made all the difference in my life and the lives of my family. You. But as much as support teams on the sidelines encourage us, and as much as the example of others who've gone before us inspire us, and as much as those still coming after us motivate us, there is nothing like the help and the hope that comes from those who run beside us as we run. We've often heard synod means walking together, right? Well, that's not fast enough. We're running the race together. And our opportunity is, as Luther once put it, our opportunity in life is to be one blind beggar who leads another to the water of life. Well, we're one sore runner who helps the next one to the next water station, right? From that baptismal plunge all the way to the finish line. And we're not here to heckle each other. We're not here to tear each other down. We're not here to trip each other up. It's hard enough. And besides, there are others watching. You know, I go to these races and I'm part of them sometimes, and I know there are people watching and they're cheering, but they're watching. Because I know I've sat on the sideline sometimes watching too, and as I do, and maybe it's just me and maybe it wouldn't be you, but as I do, I see them running and I think, you know, I wish I was out there. I really ought to be out there. And there are others who are watching us too, and that's the thought that's going through their mind as they watch us run our race. They're thinking, I ought to be out there. With this great cloud of witnesses around us, let us run with perseverance the race that's laid out for us, looking to Jesus, And as one translation puts it, looking to Jesus who gives us our faith from start to finish. From splash to ash, from baptism to ashes, to dust, looking to Jesus, who is with us every step of the way, every step of the long, hard way. He won't quit on us. He carries us when we fall, all the way to the end. Run the course, win the prize. You know, I only came with one goal today. That was to thank you and to encourage you. So thank you for what you've done for me and for my family. And keep on. It's been my great joy to run with you for a little while today. Thanks very much.